In this episode of Drinking Made Easy, we take a trip to the Cape. We take a dip, a leap, and a spill. It's Drinking Made Easy, Cape Cod. I'm Zane Lamprey, and my job is to drink. I'm traveling around with my mascot, Steve McKenna, and my buddy Pleplius as we explore the local drinking cultures, customs, and cocktails. Along the way, we'll soak in the local flavor in an effort to make drinking easy. We head over to Hyannis Harbor to meet up with a man by the name of Beezer at a little place called Trader Ed's. Beezer's known for creating Trader Ed's most popular drink, the Beezer Pleaser.
This says, Beezer Pleaser, non-alcoholic frozen drinks.
Why does it say that?
I don't know. It's a misprint, I guess.
I'm gonna show you how to fix it. It's really easy, watch. You see what I did there?
Awesome.
I just fixed it. I can fix other things too. I can change prices, whatever you want.
The Beezer Pleaser is made with watermelon rum, pina colada mix, strawberry daiquiri mix, melon liqueur, and watermelon slice as garnish. Start by pouring a whole lot of watermelon rum into a blender.
I know. At what pace? 10 count.
That's good.
Next, add strawberry daiquiri mix and pina colada mix.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Now it's time to blend. Take a plastic cup and sink in some melon liqueur.
It's a reverse float.
What, a reverse float? How much am I doing?
We don't count.
No, you do count. I want you to know that you do. Seriously, you count. To everybody here, you count. They love you, man.
Then top off with our icy concoction. Garnish with a watermelon wedge.
Sort of put it on like that.
Perfect.
And a straw. To finish it off, make it look like a stem by filling the straw with melon liqueur.
That's awesome.
And to make it just a little bit more manly, top it off with a dollop of whipped cream.
Perfect.
So is this a race?
You guessed it. The boys must suck the contents of their cup through the straw without touching the cup. First to finish wins. On your mark, get set, go. And they're off. Mm. Lamprey sucks hard, but his straw gets clogged. McKenna and Beezer push through the brain freeze and continue to drain their cups.
Oh my God, what's wrong with you, man?
Beezer is in the zone and pays no attention to Lamprey's trash talk.
Do you not feel pain?
It's coming down to the wire, and it's clear that no one's gonna catch Beezer.
Give up.
And Beezer breezes through his Beezer Pleaser and takes home the victory.
How did you do that? Doesn't your head hurt?
Yeah.
Do you feel like you're gonna pass out or vomit?
Yeah.
Wow, that was impressive.
Now that we've shown how manly we are, I asked Beezer about the famous Trader Ed's Belly Flop Contest.
We have a belly flop contest once a year for a charity event that we have. Last year, a friend of mine, Johnny English, took first place in it.
What did he do? That was so awesome.
It wasn't awesome, it was pretty disgusting.
Really?
Steve and I had poolside with Beezer and current champ, Johnny English, to take part in a belly flop exhibition.
Each of these contestants will get one jump. The girls will be judging on splash height, water displacement, and pizzazz. The flop with the highest score is the winner. McKenna's the hairiest, so he's first.
Hey, here we go!
McKenna stumbles off the platform, spreads his arms, but doesn't quite get parallel to the water, and that will not get a high score. To impress the judges, Lamprey does a three-quarter flip into a perfect backflop. Because Lamprey didn't technically do a belly flop, he receives a low score from the bikini-clad judges.
That looks like 6 to me!
Next is hometown favorite, Beezer the Pleaser. He jumps, arches his back, and smacks his belly on the water. That will get a good score from the judges. Last up is defending champ, Johnny English. It's clear that he's more physically prepared than his competition. He angles his jump towards the judges, and hits the water in a perfect belly flop. Now that is how it's done. And it's clear that Johnny English remains Trader Ed's belly flop champion.
Our next stop is Truro Vineyards. I've consumed a lot of wine, so I decide to give props and give back by bottling some. So I have winemaker David Roberts put me to work.
I will not break a bottle, I promise.
Come on, man.
Was that me?
No. This machine was not designed to handle this bottle, so it drops them once in a while.
We're packaging Truro's Lighthouse series, which come in special lighthouse-shaped bottles.
So this whole system was made for a standard wine bottle.
Right, and there's different changeover parts. We use a little of each on this just because of the funky shape of the bottle.
How many different varietals?
16 different wines.
Oh, wow. And what kind go into the Lighthouse bottle?
Well, what we're bottling right now is called a Moore's Diamond. Very grapey, very aromatic, kind of off-dry wine.
This is a design that's unique to you guys?
Yes, we own that mold.
Come on, Steve. You gotta keep up, brother.
Get the boxes down here.
They're
trying to keep the inserts in.
As they enter the line, the bottles are picked up and washed to ensure there's no outside contaminants.
In case there's any cardboard dust in the bottle.
Next is the gas purge. A small amount of nitrogen is shot into the bottom of each bottle. The layer protects the wine from oxidation.
The objective is to have the wine not touch air.
Not touch oxygen.
Now, the bottle moves into the filler. A pressure-sensitive valve ensures the bottles are filled consistently.
It's just a gravity-fed valve. As the bottle comes up, pushes that valve open, it just fills up to the O-ring on the valve and stops. Every bottle's gonna be the same. We check in the morning, first few bottles off, we'll measure out, make sure it's 750 milliliters.
Then it moves down the line where a cork is added. Because of the unique shape, each bottle has to be capped and labeled by hand.
Can we do that?
Absolutely.
So Steve and I head over to the labeling station to finish off the process.
It's not capsuled or labeled on the machine. We do that by hand right here at this station. It's a heat shrinker, this PVC plastic.
Okay.
I put them on here in the box.
All right, so put it on and then?
And then, yeah.
After the cap is in place, the neck is exposed to high temperatures, which shrink the plastic and seal the bottle.
Do I need to line it up or is it going to
do this? No, it'll be fine.
So 1001. So give me a grade on that one.
That's perfect.
The last step is putting on the label.
All right, Steve, your turn.
David shows Steve how to properly place the labels.
And in the bottom edge of the door up at about 3 o'clock, and then you just pop that actuator and puts the labels on. That's dead center on the door. And then the back is over the little notch. That's exactly what we want to see.
After a little bit of practice, Steve finally gets the hang of it.
Good job. So if you didn't have this custom bottle, they would come right off the line.
Correct.
Into the boxes.
Capsule, ready to go into the shop or be delivered to local restaurant or liquor store.
Steve finishes off the last bottle, and our special box of wine goes onto the pallet. Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, the first ever Drinking Made Easy Sextathlon. Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. As you know, this is a show about drinking, but it's also a drinking game. So there's rules involved. Whenever you're on a boat called Chaise Lounge, you have to drink. Whenever your name is Steve, you have to drink. If you have a dumb looking beard and you know who you are, you gotta drink. For the rest of the rules, go to drinkingmadeeasy.com. Next, we head over to Blackfish, a restaurant known for using fresh local ingredients. We meet up with Carrie Lardner to learn the restaurant's history and try some of their fresh cocktails.
Is Blackfish a play off of the fact that it used to be a blacksmith's shop?
Yes, it used to be called Blacksmith Shop, but a lot of people used to refer to it as the Blackie.
Okay.
So we kind of wanted to keep that. It just so happened that we called it the Blackfish. It kind of came to us.
Right.
We stuck with it. We're glad we did. We love our sign out there. We don't have a typical sign. It's sort of a local artist's piece, and
it works.
So we are the Blackfish.
But we need to have a drink, because Steve's very thirsty.
Carrie suggests we make her favorite drink, the strawberry basil martini. The strawberry basil martini is made with fresh strawberries, lime juice, basil, simple syrup, and vodka. Start by adding fresh strawberries to a pint glass.
Since these are the first of the season, I'm gonna add three.
Yes, let's do it.
That's a nice one.
Yeah.
Next, add a lime wheel.
Oh! What?
That is really good.
Come on, that's impressive.
I'll drink to that.
Some basil.
Is this fresh local basil?
It is fresh local basil.
It smells very organic.
An ounce of simple syrup.
Very good.
Then muddle.
I'm marrying the flavors.
Exactly.
Right, so then I believe I did
well
it right
put,
there.
Well put.
Add vodka.
Good.
Now this is 888.
Yes.
Nantucket, which is an island just off of Cape Cod.
We consider the Cape and islands local.
Some people would consider Nantucket part of the Cape Cod family.
Yes.
Tell that to someone in Nantucket and they'll be like this. Trust me.
They'll
slap you with a glove and be like, no, we are not part of Cape Cod, we are our own isle. That's how people talk over there. I don't know if you've been there. With a slight British accent, like John Lithgow. He's from here, but he sounds like he's not. Okay, now what?
We want to add ice. Yeah.
So add ice and shake.
Come on, baby. Come on. Be on the money.
Keep pouring.
Oh, yeah. I knew it was there.
Typically, we would garnish these with a little bit of basil. Do we have any left?
Hold on. I'm going to go to the kitchen.
While I'm in the kitchen trying to find more basil, Steve and Carrie go behind my back.
It's going to take a while.
What? To find basil?
I don't know. That
we should both drink ours.
Right? Okay.
Can I chug them?
Yes. Cheers.
Yeah.
I have local lettuce.
Oh.
What'd you guys do?
That's from...
That's local lettuce.
That's from Roxbury.
What? Just what happened?
We got thirsty.
She drank them.
Next, we head over to Cape Cod Beer to host this week's six-pack challenge. But before Steve and I face off, I meet up with Ron Cotty to try some of their locally made beer. Ron suggests that I start with their flagship, the red.
Steve, we need two of the reds.
Cape Cod Beer Red?
Yeah.
So this is the red.
Thank you. A lot of people want us to try their IPAs. A lot of people are proud of their IPAs. But what is a red?
Red is a beer that is going to have a little bit more darker malt in it. This has got crystal malt with still a little bit of a hop profile going on there. So you still get a little bitterness, you get a little bit of hop finish in the end, but you get a good, strong malt background. We use what's called crystal malt. If you're going to do a stout or a porter, you would use a chocolate or a black or even a roasted malt.
So you're saying that when you cook malt, you go from a golden color to a red and then to a dark brown?
You could go through like tan to amber, then a redder, then brown, then black.
So red is one of those steps?
It is. The red is brought on by the color of the malt. There's a kind of a fuzzy line between a red and IPA.
The amount of hops for a red doesn't really matter. It's the color of the beer.
You want to have enough hops to stand up to the sweetness of the malt.
And so an amber is just one stage lighter than a red.
A little bit, yeah.
And what's one stage darker?
You might get into a porter.
A porter.
Now that I've tasted their beer, it's time to prepare for the six-pack challenge. So I ask Ron and the rest of the brewery who they think will win.
So I'm going to challenge Steve in a Cape Cod Beer sextathlon, which has nothing to do with sex. It has all to do with beer. So it's me versus Steve. Who do you choose?
I'd say you'd have the advantage.
Of course I do! Okay, so who's picking Steve?
I'd pick Steve's beer.
Okay. It appears that Steve has some sort of home field advantage.
And you pick me?
Yes.
Let the games begin. Cape Cod beer, sex.
Tathlon.
It's time for the six-pack challenge. The first event in the Cape Cod Beer Sextathlon is the keg top toss. Lamprey and McKenna will take turns throwing a plastic keg top into a basket 40 feet away.
Somewhere.
McKenna throws one up. It looks good, but just misses. It skips off some boxes and nearly goes in.
Oh!
Angle of the day.
Oh, I can do that.
Oh, okay, I got a new technique.
Lamprey thinks he's figured out his technique. Oh! And it's in.
Come on! That's one.
That's one event for Lamprey. The next event is the triple pony roll. They have to roll three stacked half kegs over the finish line.
On your mark. Get set. Go.
And they're off. Lamprey gets a jump and leaves McKenna in the dust.
Yeah!
The second event goes to Lamprey. The next challenge will see who can drink from an ice-cold, continuous stream of beer the longest. The system pushes out a pint of beer every 20 seconds, and it's a cold 39 degrees, which makes it difficult to drink because it constricts the throat. Let the sucking begin. It looks like a scene from The Right Stuff, but this is the wrong stuff.
Yeah.
11.
Keep on going, man. You got it, dude.
It looks like Lamprey's starting to struggle. And he's having some difficulty keeping up with the flow. Lamprey can't hold on, and McKenna cruises to an easy victory. It's 2-1 in Lamprey's favor.
Keep going, man.
Event number four is the log toss. a different configuration of the half keg, the log weighs 87 pounds. These vessels are empty and weigh about 20 pounds each. So the boys should be able to hurl these pretty far.
So like right here? Or like right there?
Just right here. It's not really gonna matter. I'm gonna destroy you.
Lamprey has honors.
Spinning release.
Lamprey's first toss is an impressive 53 feet. It's McKenna's turn. Ah! That is an unimpressive 49 feet. Lamprey's next toss is off the mark.
Whoa.
But he's even with his previous throw of 53 feet. McKenna's next attempt, 54 feet, 1 foot longer than Lamprey's best.
He beat me?
I say he's got you by about a foot.
Lamprey digs deep for his last attempt.
Ah!
And it's 55 feet. McKenna has one last throw. Lamprey stands on the spot where his longest throw landed. Ah! McKenna throws. And it's past Lamprey. McKenna wins this event and ties up the beer sextathlon.
I feel so inspired.
How'd you do that?
I don't know. Do we have that on video where I just beat you?
Yeah, I think the whole point is to get it on video.
The next event is the triple keg run. The boys must make three runs. First with the pony kegs.
Go.
That McKenna drops.
It's gonna cost me.
Then with the logs, which weigh 87 pounds apiece. Then they have to move to the full keg, technically a half barrel, which weigh 160 pounds. Lamprey wins and easily takes back a lead of 3-2.
Got me on that one.
The last event is the pallet jack. The first person to get his pallet across the line is the winner.
Go.
And they're off. And they start jacking. The first step is to jack up their load and clear the wheels. Then roll the pallets with backward steering over the line. And Lamprey has it in the bag. But there's some debate whether McKenna won on a technicality.
My pallet's across the line.
But is the pallet jack across the line?
No, it's not. No, everything had to be across the line.
Wait, what's happening?
Lamprey senses a mutiny.
The rules were laid out in the beginning.
I was so far ahead of Steve.
Wait, that's your fault, man.
It's never over until it's over.
Okay, so 3-3.
Yeah!
I was being nice.
Cape Cod Beer is clearly rooting for the bearded one.
3-3.
Fine, 3-3. I chug off.
The tiebreaker is a chug-off. The person to finish their pint first is the winner.
On your mark, get set, go.
They both have a little spillage on liftoff. McKenna seems to be filling his beard for later. McKenna is down first, but he jimmed the cop all over himself as Lamprey finishes his beer with dignity. The house rules in favor of McKenna.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, we introduce you to Chad.
Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. For a list of the locations we went in this episode, as well as the cocktails we made.
And the things that we forgot.
Why are you pointing at me?
Because you're
Are you directing
to...
me?
Yeah.
Hey, what? Go to drinkingmadeeasy.com. Get your stupid lumberjack hands off me. You look like the guy in the brawny toilet paper roll.
I got you in a headlock.
Our next stop is over in Wellfleet at one of the coolest spots on the Cape. Nestled in the dunes over Cahoon Hollow Beach, Beachcombers is Cape Cod's only oceanfront restaurant and club. We sit down with the owner to find out the story behind this historic beachside club.
Well, how long has this place been yours?
34 years. It was a restaurant.
Oh, it was a restaurant.
Since 1953. Before that, it was a life-saving station.
And how did you come to own the place?
I met a guy in a bar one night. Said it was for sale. He goes, you should go come down and look at this place.
That's how a lot of good places get started. I was in a bar one night.
I'm told that while we're here, we have to try their signature drink, the Goombay Smash.
We make it in jugs. You pre-mix it with the rum and the juices. Preferably let it sit overnight. It kind of ferments a little bit.
What's that?
That is the Goombay Smash.
And so you guys make a bunch of these before a big weekend, right?
I've got about, 10 of those?
To keep up with the weekend rush, Beachcombers pre-mixes the Goombay Smash in marked containers.
We got rum up to...
Boom, apricot brandy.
Wow, it's so easy when you actually have the lime.
Shake it up.
Okay. You want to try a sip of that?
Yeah.
There you go.
There you go.
Like
there
a
you
go. There like you go.
You're gonna want to get some of it in your face.
Come here. Let me see the beer.
Yeah. Get a little bit. Yeah. There you go.
Ow!
Yeah. Bring it out.
Ow!
Bring it out. Bring it out.
What do you think?
Yeah.
That's a lot. Hold on 1 second. Don't move.
Steve tainted that batch with his beard, so I decided to make everyone a smaller, cleaner version. The Goombay Smash is made with amber rum, coconut rum, pineapple juice, orange juice, apricot brandy, and dark rum. Start with a 1/2 ounce of amber rum. Then add a 1/4 ounce of coconut rum.
One count.
Okay.
One, stop, thank you. Oh, Jesus.
The opposite of what you just said.
1/2 ounce of apricot brandy.
This one.
Stop, 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 stop.
It's almost quick, like stop quick. Before I even start.
Roll into a shaker and top it off with dark rum. As I try to get these drinks out the door, I notice that Tad the sound guy is preoccupied.
Tad! I'm trying to shoot something over here. Will you stop drinking the Goombay Smash?
Tad's our sound guy, and he's very good at his job. But sometimes we force him to get in on the fun.
Hey, you want
to
try this?
And after a few drinks, he goes from Tad to his Steve McKenna alter ego, who we lovingly call Chad.
There is a thing called Goombay races. Who finishes their Goombay first?
Who sucks the most?
Now that the drinks are made, Thor convinces me to take part in a Beachcomber Goombay sip-off.
It's time for another challenge. As always, the first person to drain their cup is the winner. With lips on straws, everyone's ready to start. Producer Mel counts it down.
Ready?
Yeah.
2, 3, go.
Everyone gets off to a clean start, and it looks like they all suck at this. In a good way. Thor clearly has superior sucking skills and claims victory.
After a hard-fought race, we follow Tad the sound guy out to the dunes.
Oh my God.
I'm pretty sure Steve is Steve McKenna because he's taking his shirt off and is heading straight for the 80-foot drop off the dunes. And of course, I follow close behind. Our next stop is on the tip of the Cape in Provincetown. Old Colony Tap is a local dive that can't be missed. We jump behind the bar with Leonard Enos to find out what makes his Old Colony so special.
This is a local institution, and you guys don't necessarily have local stuff. You guys just are local.
Like to think so.
Right now, where we are, I want a beer right now. What are you going to have?
Harpoon IPA.
Can we get 2 of those?
Absolutely.
Old Colony Tap has been serving Harpoon since the company opened in 1986.
The guys came around selling their product, and we put it on. Salud.
With beers in hand, I ask Leonard what makes the bar so successful.
It's just us, man. It's our thing, it's our scene. It's the look, it's the feel.
And this place is more about the people that come here and the guy behind the bar.
Absolutely.
As opposed to what you're mixing up back here. Double.
So, are you more of a local bar or a tourist bar?
Well, I think we're a little bit of everything to everybody. A lot of artists that come here to do their work, paint, write, whatnot.
You have free Wi-Fi?
We do, actually.
Really? That's awesome.
I know, right?
If you want to go to a bar, you come here.
Is it intentional that you have a nautical theme at your bar?
The decor here was largely picked up on the back beaches out here. My grandfather, his buddies. That's what people did in the 40s, 50s, 60s around here. This bell, you know, it's traded. It's bartered off.
Someone paid their bar tab with that bell?
This bar itself is built from ship planks.
Really?
People ask, why are the knots so uniform? They're not knots. It's from a boat, man. This right here is an oar.
Chad, you think your levels are good?
Perfect. We were told that we had to come to Provincetown before we left Cape Cod. Why?
This is the first landing place of the Pilgrims, contrary to what the history books tell you.
If the Pilgrims did not land at Plymouth, they landed here?
That is correct.
Now that I downed a local beer, I want a local shot. So I asked Leo what a local would drink.
People here drink everything, man.
I have a challenge.
Ah.
I'll challenge Steve to everything.
And the great Thor has a great idea.
What do you want to do, a shot of everything?
Well, he said they drink everything.
Okay.
I'll have everything.
Fine. If he wants an everything shot, then that's what he'll get.
You want it iced? Don't worry about it.
For hours, we had vodka, tequila, rum, gin, coconut rum, amaretto.
This is a bad decision day.
Triple sec, cinnamon schnapps, chartreuse, Grand Marnier, whiskey, and top with some dry vermouth.
So this is around the world. Even though we only poured about 30 shots, we incorporated about 76 countries. God.
Oh. It actually looks like piss.
And then here's Steve. Just keep that one going. Yeah, milk it. Milk the tea.
And there you have it. The everything shot.
I'm not gonna lie to you. It smells offensive.
It smells like cayenne pepper.
It does smell. It does smell like pepper.
No more stalling. It's time to drink.
Yeah!
Yum.
You know what? I'm not offended by it.
I'm not either.
Cape Cod, baby.
That's it.
Check us out on Facebook and at drinkingmadeeasy.com.